My name is Christopher Pointbo. I'm one of the organizers for the Compare Canada's Comparele Ville Canada. And I have the honor to introduce you to our guest today, our first of two keynote speakers. Before we start, we wish to acknowledge the slang on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississaugas of the Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Islands, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. This acknowledgement is in fact particularly relevant in today's keynote talk. Associate Professor in the Department of French and in the Centre for Comparative Literature at the University of Toronto, Barbara Havercroft has published extensively on contemporary life writing, especially by French and Quebecois women authors, on the literary encounter between feminism and postmodernism, on the theory and writing of trauma, and on the extreme contemporary in French literature. The former editor-in-chief of the learned journal RSSI, Recherche Sémiotique, Semiotic Inquiry. She is also the co-founder and co-director of the research group GALFA, Groupe de Recherche et d'études sur la langue française, sur la littérature française d'aujourd'hui, in the Department of French at the University of Toronto. Her recent book publications include Vie en récit, forme littéraire et médiatique de la biographie et de l'autobiographie, Le roman français de l'extrême contemporain, écriture, engagement, énonciation, and Narration d'un nouveau siècle, roman et récit français, 2001 à 2010. Her next book, entitled Politique de l'autobiographie, engagement et subjectivité, is forthcoming later this year at Édition de Tabelle. She has edited a large number of issues of learned journals, including with Michael Sheringham, Fiction de soi, Self-Fictions, an issue of the Revue Critique de Fiction Française Contemporaine, Critical Review of Contemporary French Fiction. And she is currently working on a book manuscript entitled Trauma et Texte dans l'extrême contemporain français au féminin, the research for which was funded by a grant from the Social Sciences and Humanities Research Council of Canada. She has received several awards for her work, including the Florence Howe Prize from the Modern Language Association for Excellence in Feminist Literary Scholarship. She was also twice awarded the ADFIC Prize for the best article published in French by a member of that association. In 2016, she was chosen to be the International Visiting Fellow by the UK Society for French Studies and did a lecture tour around England and Scotland. And so it is with utmost pride and honor that I introduce today an inspiration role model of mine, whose talk has the title Made in Canada, Trauma Discourse Beyond the Two Solitudes. And so, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Professor Barbara Havercroft.
I'm going to start with the same acknowledgement that Chris just read to you. I wish to acknowledge this land in which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of the Huron Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently the Mississaugas of the Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still home to many Indigenous peoples from across Turtle Island, and I am grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. I'd also like to begin by thanking the Conference Organizing Committee for inviting me. I'll name them in case you don't know who they are. Chris Poulin-Thibault, whom you just saw, Amelia Bailey, Ella Wilhelm, Nathaniel Harrington, and the two Matthews, Matthew Larocque-Poulin and Matthew Damoteau. I am absolutely honored and delighted to be invited to present the Linda and Ted talk, all the more so because Linda was a valued member of my thesis committee when I did my PhD, and remains a much admired mentor and a dear friend. So it's a great honor, and I'm terribly flattered to be doing this talk. But this welcome invitation did put me in a bit of a quandary, because I'm not a comparative Canadianist. I'm not a specialist of what Hugh McLennan once called the two solitudes, that is English Canadian literature and Quebecois literature. I do work on contemporary Quebecois women writers, but I don't do comparisons, say, with Margaret Atwood or other Canadian women writers who write in English. For the past several years, I've been working on the profusion of recent autobiographical narratives of personal trauma, Rape, Incest, Family Violence, Life-Threatening Illness, and Mourning, published by contemporary French in France women writers. But for this talk, I really wanted to present something that would specifically address the conference theme of comparing Canadas. So I decided to work on two different trauma texts, one representing recent refugees who arrived well after the French and English colonizers, and one representing people whose ancestors were living here long before the representatives of the two solitudes arrived, the Aboriginal peoples. And I wish to make it very clear that I'm not a specialist of Indigenous literature, so I'm not speaking from any kind of position of authority or thorough knowledge of that literature. I do feel, however, that the texts I have chosen for today's study are timely and appropriate, as one deals with a refugee story of a boat person who immigrated from Vietnam to Quebec. Every night on the news, we witness the plight of thousands of refugees, whether on foot across our snowy borders or on overcrowded, unsafe boats on the Mediterranean or elsewhere. My second text is the memoir of a survivor of an Aboriginal residential school in British Columbia. Given the recent release of the final report of U of T's Truth and Reconciliation Steering Committee, the creation of U of T's Master of Social Work program in Indigenous Trauma and Resiliency, and increased public awareness of the trauma of residential schools, thanks in part to Gord Downie's Secret Path album and the accompanying book about Chaney Wenjack's tragic death in 1966, I wished personally to learn more about the trauma and atrocities at these residential school institutions. So you've had a little bit of an introduction to this with Jessica's talk that we heard just earlier. The subject of my talk is situated, in fact, at the junction of two major areas in contemporary theory and representational practice: the rise of autobiography and subgenres, memoirs, confessions, autofictions, diaries, and other forms of personal writings as a significant field unto itself, and the rapid development of interdisciplinary trauma studies over the past 20, 25 years or so. So what I propose to you this afternoon is the following itinerary. First, after a short introduction, I'll discuss some, but not all, of the theoretical issues concerning the ethics and aesthetics of trauma narratives. And then I'm going to analyze two specific texts. First, I'm going to consider Kim Thuy's book, which originally came out in French, but there's been an English translation. And then Bev Sellers' Indigenous book. Her memoir is entitled, They Called Me Number One, Secrets and Survival at an Indian Residential School. And my focus in examining these texts is going to be on the aesthetics, poetics, and ethics of writing trauma, and particularly on the discursive means used to express what some theoreticians call the unspeakable. So I'll start with a little introduction. If, as Lee Gilmore has claimed, the age of trauma and the age of memoir have coincided at the turn of the millennium, this conjunction is perhaps nowhere more evident than in the contemporary profusion of autobiographical writings devoted to extreme traumatic, catastrophic experiences where the abject prevails. Recent years have witnessed the publication of numerous trauma texts dealing with incest, family violence, rape, life-threatening illness, or the death of a parent or child. I'm thinking of French writers such as Annie Ernaux, Christine Angot, Camille Laurence, and Chloé Delhomme. In addition to these texts of personal trauma, there are also those which recount collective catastrophes, such as the Shoah or genocides, horrors which are narrated in texts dealing with World War II, as in Patrick Modiano's works on the occupation of France, or the literature of the concentration camps, such as Marguerite de Duras's La Douleur, or Charlotte Delbault's poignant Auschwitz trilogy. There's also the narrative of children of deportees, as in deceased French philosopher Sarah Kaufman's Rue Ordinaire, Rue Là-Bas, and of course, Georges Perec's W, or the Memory of Childhood, W, or Le Souvenir d'Enfance. In Canada, of course, we have those texts dealing with state-sponsored atrocities at the residential schools, such as Sellers' memoir and another one, which I read, called, it's by Theodore Fontaine, or Fontaine, I guess he's Anglophone, entitled Broken Circle, The Dark Legacy of Indian Residential Schools, published in 2010. Sellers' book was published in 2013. The authors of these trauma narratives use various forms of autobiographical writing to effect a change of status, to go from being the object of violence and of traumatic memory to being a subject and even in some cases an agent. The writing of the past here allows for survival in the present and the future. For these writers, revisiting the traumatic episodes, memories, and obsessive symptoms that plague them is a means of working through, of transforming them, of reconfiguring them, and at the same time of recovering them, at least to some extent. The autobiographical act in these texts is thus a discursive doing, a writing endowed with a performative dimension. For the narration of the trauma is also the means of acting in and on one's own life, of testifying, in some cases, to the secret violence which the survivor suffered. What interests me in these texts is how these writers find the discursive means of narrating that which is purportedly beyond expression, that which is unspeakable. How does one represent that which defies representation? What is the nature of trauma that makes its representation so particular, so difficult? And how do traumatized subjects testify to their experiences? Do the symptoms of PTSD find expression in their texts? I'm thinking of post-traumatic stress syndrome, stress disorder symptoms like hallucinations, nightmares, recurring dreams, flashbacks, depression, a state of hypervigilance, insomnia, lack of concentration, a loss of control of oneself and of one's environment, a lack of interest for the activities that formerly gave one's life meaning. Since Freud and Pierre Janet, scholars in the field of trauma studies agree on the importance of the narration of the traumatic event in the form of what Kathy Caruth calls a meaningful story. According to this view, the subject is only able to recover from her trauma in most cases by the use of language and narration, through which the object of the trauma becomes the subject of her story. If, however, trauma is beyond words and thus unspeakable, one must nevertheless find the means to express it, to make a narrative of and from it, and this story must be heard by an open, understanding, and receptive audience. As Shoshana Feldman and Dori Laub explain in their study of Claude Lanzmann's film Shoah, I quote them, "The necessity of testimony, it affirms, derives paradoxically enough from the impossibility of testimony that the film at the same time dramatizes." In my research on this subject, I've noted a certain rhetoric which expresses this paradox of trauma, this oxymoric coupling of the impossibility versus the necessity or the possibility of recounting trauma. In discussions of this dilemma, one often hears such expressions that have become almost cliche utterances in writing on this topic. I'm thinking of such instances of the oxymoron as saying the unsayable, expressing the inexpressible, representing that which exceeds or defies representation, speaking the unspeakable, or in French we often hear dire l'indicible. I myself am guilty of using dire l'indicible in a paper title. That said, we must acknowledge the large quantity of recent literary narratives and other forms of testimony that do deal precisely with traumatic memory and events, the existence of which itself testifies to the testifying of that which supposedly defies testimony. These verbal and visual representations of trauma, while highlighting the unspeakable in both senses of the word, character of the incidents to which they refer, demonstrate that they are not entirely or absolutely unspeakable, contrary to the conception communicated by the various incarnations of the oxymoron I mentioned earlier. Perhaps we can retain the notion of the unspeakable if we realize that the Shoah and other traumatic experiences exceed the means of verbal and visual representation that we normally have at our disposal, that is, our usual frames of reference or interpretation used to represent facts, which are determined and situated historically, culturally, socially, and discursively. What this means, according to philosopher Thomas Trezise, is that neither one single representation nor the totality of all possible representations could produce a complete, comprehensive, objective, or definitive version of the Shoah or other traumatic incidents, what he calls the comprehensive view from nowhere. Indeed, to recognize the existence of numerous representations of trauma is also to recognize that it is not situated entirely outside or inside of language. Since, first of all, to characterize it as being totally exterior to language is already to interpret what ostensibly exceeds interpretation. And secondly, to claim that trauma is merely a question of representation or interpretation, it is not only to ignore the extra-textual referent, the disturbing event itself, but it is also to ignore the extent to which language itself has been affected or modified by the trauma as an event. So this brings me to a crucial point. What discursive, linguistic, rhetorical, or enunciative means are used or are called upon to represent the excess and suffering of trauma? Which particular devices testify to the aporia of trauma? As Jean-François Lyotard states in Le Différent, the different, signs are not reference to which verifiable meanings can be attached in the cognitive realm. They indicate that something that must be put into sentences cannot be, using the usual idiom. Now, a little bit on the aesthetics of the trauma narrative. As difficult as the narration of a trauma is, it remains, according to most theoreticians, essential to healing or partial recovery of the survivor, according to many scholars. This is because the narrative enables the survivor, in many cases, to exercise a greater control over her traumatic memories and other troubling symptoms, to better master her environment, and to reestablish a rapport with humanity. Such a narrative may also provide the victim with the means of integrating the disturbing episode into the larger narrative of her life, before and after the incident, and to become an active subject instead of a passive object of violence, as Susan Bryson contends. Trauma constitutes a challenge to narrative capacities, but if its shock impact is anti-narrative, it simultaneously generates a series of retrospective narratives that seek to explain it. For a minority of scholars, any poetic or aesthetic qualities in a trauma narrative are to be strictly avoided in favor of a documentary, non-figurative mode of discourse. And one of the scholars who is a proponent of this view is Beryl Lang in his book, Act and Idea in the Nazi Genocide. These scholars establish a direct correlation between ethical failure and aesthetic success, as if figurative language were suspect, as if the use of tropes and figures distances us too much from the referent, seducing the reader by the very language used. As Thomas Trezise points out in his lengthy discussion of this point of view, I quote him, "The artistic mediation of experience, whether its purpose be pleasure, understanding, or both, is considered tantamount to moral betrayal, to a renewed obliteration or silencing of victims." In this same article, it's called Unspeakable. This article is an excellent article. Trezise develops a long and detailed discussion of why he considers the indirect ascription of moral superiority to so-called non-figurative representations of the Holocaust to be, as he puts it, less than compelling. However, that said, numerous theoreticians underscore the necessity of the artistic transposition of trauma. Lee Gilmore notes the important role of fiction and literary devices such as holes in the narrative. Régine Aubin mentions the non-chronological temporality that characterizes certain of these texts, the play with literary genres, the frequent recourse to metaphors and other figures. And it's precisely on temporal games in verbal and visual trauma texts that Roger Luckhurst insists in his book, The Trauma Question. According to Luckhurst, many of these texts refuse a linear narrative and a logical narrative progression, where the links between cause and effect would be obvious and evident. In addition, he notes, these texts also feature belated revelations, which reorient the meaning of the narrative. In The Limits of Autobiography, Trauma, and Testimony, Lee Gilmore speaks of what she calls the lyrical subject of trauma, a subject aiming not so much at a mimetic reconstruction or representation of the painful experience as a poetic rendering thereof, which would, according to her, be actually more faithful to the experience in question. Now, another important characteristic of several trauma narratives and which contributes to their aesthetics is the use of repetition. be it lexical or other, which echoes the unconscious language of repetition through which the trauma has already been expressed in the form of nightmares, flashback, and other types of repetitive phenomena. And finally, a good number of trauma narratives contain a direct appeal to you, the reader, foregrounding Roman Jakobson's functions of communication, in particular the conative emphatic function. Certain scholars, such as Bryson, Fellman, and Lowe, reiterate this necessity of an audience or receiver who is prepared to listen and to understand the victim's words, as this is an essential part of the healing process, of the reconstruction or remaking of the wounded self in the aftermath of trauma. This dependency on the other results at times in the explicit presence of the anticipated listener in the text, as in Christine Angot's text Incest, where the pronoun you is a constant feature. She is already anticipating readers' reactions and telling them what she thinks it's going to be. Trauma texts are thus likely to include a number of the different communicative functions theorized by Jakobson: poetic, phatic, referential, emotive, conative, and metalinguistic, rendering them texts of great complexity. According to Carole Daunier, a French scholar, testimony is the autobiographically certified narrative of a past event that someone has witnessed. It presupposes, just like autobiography and autofiction, that the author, the narrator, and the main protagonist are one and the same, indicated by the use of the same proper name to identify all three of these discursive positions. In theoretical writings on testimony, and I'm talking about this just briefly because many trauma narratives are also considered to be forms of testimony, emphasis is placed on the ethical character of the genre, on the presence of the witness at the scene of the episode in question, and on the witness's capacity to speak for other victims who have known a similar incident. The witness addresses herself to an interlocutor or listener who is called upon to believe the witness's narrative. And then this listener, as we are when we read these texts, these listeners become, according to Jacques Derrida, the witness of the witness, le témoin du témoin. And this is in his book, Poétique et politique du témoignage, published in 2005. Often used by trauma victims, the testimonial narrative has as its objectives the revelation and the healing of the fracture that the event has often caused in the identity of the person who is recounting the story, restoring the place of the victim who has been lost in the human community, and communicating a message that warns and educates the public. While one might assume that the testimonial narrative is strictly factual, with the referential dimension emphasized over any imaginative content, it must be remembered that the narrator's imagination and subjectivity inevitably come into play in the representation of any traumatic incident, and may even lead to a better understanding of the episode than the rendering of just plain, unvarnished facts. A number of theoreticians, such as Carole Daunier, Renaud Dunant, and François Bastier, insist on the aesthetic character of much testimony. But Derrida goes even farther than this. He proposes, and I'm quoting him here in my translation, all responsible testimony engages a poetic experience of language. According to Derrida, the very idea of proof of the facts evoked in a testimonial narrative contaminates the meaning of the verb to testify. And if you've read this particular book, the Poétique et Politique du Témoignage, you know that a large part of me does these little etymological excursions around the word témoigner, to testify. He says, to testify is not to prove. Testifying is heterogeneous to the administration of proof or to the showing of evidence. When one says, I testify, one does not say necessarily, I prove, but I swear that I saw, I heard, I touched, I felt, I was present. This having been present, or being present in the memory of the witness, requires her to tell the truth, according to Derrida, which Derrida describes as a promise, the performity of which is constitutive of testimony and makes of it an engagement, an engagement. Now, I'm going to turn my attention to how some of these issues play themselves out in the two texts I mentioned to you at the beginning. As I'm going to demonstrate, hopefully, Kim Thuy's poignant text, unique in its genre as the only literary autobiographical account of the Vietnamese boat people to be published in Quebec, corresponds to certain textual features described by critics of trauma narratives. And I should just tell you a little bit about Kim Thuy in case you're not familiar with her. She has degrees in law, linguistics, and translation from the Université de Montréal. She makes her living as a writer, and since Rue has published two other novels, Man in 2013 and Vie in 2016, in addition to À Toi, a literary correspondence co-written with Pascal Janoja. Now, in the autobiographical narrative Rue, published in 2009, she recounts the story of her narrator, Nguyen An Tin. So she does not use her own name in the narrative. Her identification with the story has been provided in paratextual devices, such as interviews with her, where she said that this is my story. So we have the story of Nguyen An Tin, a refugee who survived both the perilous sea voyage from Vietnam to Malaysia, as well as the refugee camp in Malaysia before immigrating with her family to Quebec. This moving story of exile is also that of the author, born in Saigon during the Tet Offensive in 1968, who fled her homeland with some of her family members in 1978, 3 years after the fall of Saigon at the hands of the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese Army. But this traumatic story of flight and suffering is also a happy tale of successful immigration and integration into Quebecois society and culture, which gives this text a decidedly more positive tone than that of numerous other trauma narratives. The publication of Rue met with immediate success as it was acclaimed by both literary critics and readers in the general public. It won the Governor General's Award in 2010. It won the prize entitled Le Grand Public La Presse 2010, the Archambault Literary Prize in 2011, and then once it was translated into English by Sheila Fishman, and it came out in 2012, it was a finalist for the Giller Prize, won the Amazon.ca Prize for a first novel, and also won the CBC Canada Reads Contest in 2015. It's also received some critical attention, as three articles in scholarly journals have been devoted to this text. And these articles deal with fragmented memory, with the portrait of the grateful immigrant, and with the question of exile. So I'm going to discuss some of the aesthetic features that Thuy mobilizes to represent her traumatic experience as a boat person and as a refugee in the Malaysian camp. I'm going to concentrate on several things. One is the use of the fragment, that of certain rhetorical figures, metaphor, comparison, plus personification, and the combination of dysphoric and positive discursive registers. So if any of you have read this book, you'll know that it consists of an accumulation of quite brief narrative fragments, most of which are one or two paragraphs in length, which focus on a character, an event, a place, a moment in time, or an emotion. And this fragmentary form represents the logic of traumatic memory. For the narrator evokes only brief memories, incomplete and momentary flashes, which surge forth in a non-chronological order. As Ginette Michaud explains, the fragment is not only la forme de la rupture par excellence, the form of rupture par excellence, but also that of un manque, une faille constitutive du langage, a lack, a breakage point or fault constitutive of language. The fragments and the white blank spaces between them convey the difficulty of finding words capable of rendering the narrator's painful experience, but also these fragments and the blanks in between them create a reading experience of perpetual interruption. The fragments are not organized in a chronological linear manner, but proceed by continual prolepsis and analepsis, creating constant jumps in space and time. Certain fragments are linked by theme, where a recent event in Quebec since the immigration gives rise to a traumatic memory from the past. Such is the case, for example, of the description of the buzzing of flies in Quebecois swamps, mentioned in a fragment which is followed by one featuring the song, the chant, of the flies in the refugee camp, where narrator describes her experience using the toilet, if it can be designated as such. It's the first quotation you have on the handout. Je suis libre, ne pas m'évanouir, lorsque mes propres selles ou celles de la cabine voisine provoquaient une éclaboussure. Dans ces instants-là, je m'évadais en écoutant le vol des mouches. I had to crouch down above a gigantic pit filled to the brim with excrement. In the blazing sun of Malaysia, I had to keep my balance, avoid fainting, when my stools or those from the next cabin splattered. At those moments, I escaped by listening to the humming of the flies. At other points in the text, a different motif will join two completely disparate fragments together. One example is the motif of maternal love, which acts as a splicing device between fragments, suturing together the jumps in geography and time. When the narrator's young son, Henri, runs onto a busy Quebecois highway and is saved from impending death by his older brother, Pascal, the narrator begins the following fragment with an analeptic jump to the past, remembering a Vietnamese mother whose son was executed by soldiers. This young boy was also running, but in a completely different context, if you look to quote number two, for it was à travers les visières afin de transporter les messages d'un homme à l'autre, pour prêter main forte à la résistance, mais aussi pour faire voyager un simple mot d'amour. An hour before his death, that boy was running across the rice paddy with the wind in his hair to deliver messages from one man to another, to do his part for the resistance, but also sometimes to help send a simple love note on its way. In this fragment, the love between the mother and son creates the link and contrast between past and present, between death and life, between the mother in mourning who gathers up in her old mat her, the body of her son who was half buried in the mud, and the joyful mother and Tin, the narrator, surrounded by her young living sons. Now, if the fear of the communists originally acted as the motivation for the refugees' flight, the fear of death that completely dominated their lives on the boat was of such proportions that it literally took on a life of its own, becoming a monster in the narrator's mind. This is quote number three. La peur s'est transformée en un monstre à son visage, qui nous scie les jambes, nous empêchait de ressentir l'engourdissement de nos muscles immobilisés. Nous étions figés dans la peur, par la peur, emprisonnés par les épaules des uns, des gens des autres et la peur de chacun. Nous étions paralysés. Fear was transformed into a hundred-faced monster who sawed off our legs and kept us from feeling the stiffness in our immobilized muscles. We were frozen in fear, by fear, imprisoned by the shoulders of some, the legs of others, the fear of everyone. We were paralyzed. This personification of fear, accompanied by the description of the state of physical and emotional paralysis of the refugees in the overcrowded boat, poignantly renders the dangerous and pitiful conditions that the collective we, referred to as nous, frequently in this text, had to face. And at the very beginning of her narrative, Anne Tin uses visual and audio images of destruction and death to represent the Tet Offensive of 1968. Constructing two particularly striking comparisons that describe the death and murder of the soldiers. Number four, j'ai vu le jour à Saigon, là où les débris des pétards éclataient en mille miettes, colorés de sol de rouge, comme des pétales de cerisier, ou comme le sang de 2 millions de soldats déployés, éparpillés dans les villes et les villages d'un Vietnam déchiré en deux. I first saw the light of day in Saigon, where firecrackers fragmented into 1,000 shreds, colored the ground red like the petals of cherry blossoms, or like the blood of 2 million soldiers deployed and scattered throughout the villages and cities of the Vietnam that had been ripped in two. I should note that the word pétard means firecrackers, but it can also mean an explosive charge. In the first comparison, and that translation is not included in Fishman's version, in the first comparison, the scattered of the fireworks or explosive charges is compared to the delicate beauty of red cherry petals covering the ground. The The registers of destruction and softness are thus combined. But in the second comparison, Antin remains in the discursive register of death, comparing the red color of the ground to the redness of blood, evoking in this manner the high human cost and trauma of war. This image of the fallen red cherry blossoms brings to mind another similar image in the book that features flower petals in fragments. During a return trip to Vietnam years after her immigration to Quebec, the narrator recounts a surge of memories concerning the poor condition of the dangerous roads between Saigon and her father's native city. Because of the mines planted at night by communist rebels, only to be subsequently removed or exploded by pro-American soldiers during the day, the roads were riddled with crevices and fissures. Some of these mines exploded on their own, without warning, leaving human remains littered on the ground in scattered pieces that the soldiers would then gather up. Antin remembers one particular victim of these mines. This is quote 5. Un jour, une femme a été déchiquetée, entourée de fleurs de courge jaune, éparpillée, émiettée. Elle devait certainement être en route vers le marché pour les vendre. English translation, one day a woman was torn to pieces, this is by a mine, surrounded by yellow squash blossoms, scattered, fragmented. She must have been on her way to the market to sell her vegetables. So in this passage, the evocation of flowers in pieces replaces the explicit description of the torn human body, but suggests it metonymically. The fragmented flowers make a deictic gesture, pointing towards a life so suddenly and definitively interrupted, while covering the tomb and body of the victim. The narrator concludes this particular fragment with four hypotheses concerning the life that this anonymous woman could have lived, beginning each sentence with the adverb peut-être. Peut-être ont-ils aussi trouvé le corps de son bébé sous le bord là. Peut-être que non. Peut-être son mari était-il mort dans la jungle. Peut-être était-ce elle, la femme qui avait perdu son amour devant la maison de mon grand-père maternel, le préfet. Maybe they also found the body of her baby by the roadside, or not. Maybe her husband had died in the jungle. Maybe she was the woman who had lost her lover outside the house of my maternal grandfather, the prefect. The repetition of the adverb peut-être places these statements under the modality of uncertainty to emphasize the lack of precise information regarding numerous victims of the war whose identity often remained unknown. In this sense, the figure of the woman torn to shreds functions as a synecdoche, as this single example takes the place of or stands in for countless other innocent victims of a similar fate. If Thuy's text can be characterized as a trauma narrative, it nonetheless differs from many trauma texts that I have read, as the dysphoric discursive register that I've just analyzed alternates with a very positive, at times even euphoric, register that's employed throughout the entire book, but especially in fragments that are temporarily situated after the narrator and her family's arrival in Quebec. And this discursive register of happiness is created by a number of devices that I won't go into detail about here, but we should note the use of humor. And I'll give one or two examples of that, because it's quite extraordinary what she does with that. There's also the dissemination of the title rue in the text. In French, rue means a small stream, and figuratively, a discharge of tears or blood or even money. In Vietnamese, as a noun, ru means lullaby, a lullaby, and as a verb, it means to lull or cradle or rock, particularly a baby. We've got the use of the lexical field of paradise or heaven, the repetition of the words rêve, dream, and the verb rêver, to dream, and also the very positive representation of the construction of the intersubjective self, always defined into positive terms, in relation to her family members. Despite the devastating events that Antin experiences, the loss of her home, the horrors of war, the hazardous voyage on the boat, the unspeakable conditions at the Malaysian refugee camp, and the pain of exile, the traumatized subject of Rue is not the completely destroyed and irreparably wounded self that one encounters in other trauma texts. On the contrary, she demonstrates admirable resilience and optimism, having found in Quebec a space and a place that are propitious to the blossoming and flourishing of these positive qualities she already possessed. I'll give you just one example of how humor in this text responds to the darkness of the dysphoric discourse of trauma. After the arrival of the communists in Saigon, Ann Tin's family had to relinquish to them one half and subsequently the entirety of their property. They were subjected to the constant presence of inspectors in their house who made a complete inventory of all their possessions. As it happened, one young inspector neglected to take stock of the clothing in the large cupboard containing the brassieres belonging to the grandmother and her six daughters. This oversight was not due to some kind of embarrassment on his part, as one might suppose, but due to utter ignorance. If you look at quote 7, selon lui, les soutiens-gorge ressemblaient au filtre à café de sa mère, fait de tissu cousu autour d'un anneau en métal dans un bout torsadé servi de manche. So in his opinion, the brassieres looked like his mother's coffee filters, made of cloth and sewn around a metal ring, the twisted end of which served as a handle. So at the very moment of the collapse of her former life, the end of happiness and stability, with only the prospect of an endangered, uncertain future. The narrator adds this note of humor to the recounting of an eminently sad episode. Moreover, she then goes on to say she was eavesdropping on the conversation between the young inspector and his colleagues, and she weaves these pieces of reported discourse into her own text. That's quote 8. Il ne comprenait pas pourquoi ma famille avait autant de filtres de café, classés dans des tiroirs tapissés de papier de soie. Et pourquoi était-il double? Est-ce parce que les cafés se prennent toujours en compagnie d'un ami? He didn't understand why my family had so many coffee filters filed away in drawers lined with tissue paper. And why were they double? Was it because we always drink coffee with a friend? So there gives you an idea of how Anne Tin uses humor to counter the darker moments of the text. So she employs several discursive devices that are regularly found in literary trauma narratives, such as the disruptive nonlinear chronology, rhetorical figures to represent horrific experiences, repetition, the fragmentary form that literally embodies the shock of trauma and the functioning of traumatic memory. But far from presenting us with the story of one single character, that of the narrator Ann Tin, Kim Thuy provides us with a testimonial text concerning all those who disappeared or who survived the Vietnamese trauma. In this sense, as Valerie Dusayon Fernandez claims in an article dealing with this text, this narrative acts as the denunciation of the collective forgetting of the death of numerous civilians during Vietnam's tragic years as an attempt at remembering, at bringing the forgotten ones back in the world of the living, in the world of memory. Now I'm going to move on to my second text, which provides a stylistic contrast with the first. A similar resilience on the survivor's part, an analogous concern with possible forgetting, are also paramount in Bev Seller's memoir, entitled They Called Me Number One, Secrets and Survival at an Indian Residential School, published in 2013. But as she points out in the book's preface, it's not simply a matter of remembering, for one cannot recall that one which one never knew to begin with. This state of ignorance regarding the trauma that First Nations children experience at Aboriginal residential schools, in fact, characterizes most non-Aboriginal Canadians, Sellers states in her preface. And this is quote number 9. Aboriginal people in Canada have a story to tell, a story that most non-Aboriginals don't know about. Many Canadians are unaware of what happened in a country that proudly boasts of being one of the best places in the world to live, a supposedly democratic country, where the freedoms and cultures of all are protected and respected. It is the greatest place to live for anyone, except for the original inhabitants of the land, the Aboriginal people. So Sellers sets right up at the beginning the goal for herself of educating those who are unfamiliar with these traumatic events. Her testimony has, among other objectives, that of enlightenment, battling ignorance, battling prejudice. Just a couple of words about Bev Sellers. She served as the chief of the Satsul, Soda Creek First Nation in Williams Lake, BC for more than 20 years and is now a member of its council. After years of suffering and abuse at a residential school and subsequent years of trauma, healing from this trauma and recovery, she obtained a BA in history at the University of Victoria and subsequently a law degree from UBC, after which she articled in the Vancouver law firm of Miller Thompson LLP. Choosing not to pursue a career in law, she worked as a Treaty Process Community Information Advisor at the BC Treaty Commission before being elected chief of the Soda Creek Band in 1987. She is now a noted speaker on issues such as racism, residential schools, and on the effects of mineral resource exploitation on the environment in her region. For 5 years, beginning in 1962 at the age of seven, she attended the St. Joseph's Mission Residential School on the Williams Lake First Nations lands, like her mother and grandmother before her. The school operated actually for almost a century, opening on July 19, 1891, and closing on June 30, 1981, at which time it was under police investigation for extreme offenses against children. Like Kim Tree, Sellers was awarded several prizes for her narrative, including the third prize of the 2014 Bird Award for First Nations, Métis, and Inuit Literature, and the 2014 George Riga Award for Social Awareness in Literature. In addition, They Called Me Number One was also shortlisted for the 2014 Hubert Evans Nonfiction Prize, this is a BC book prize, and was on the BC bestsellers list for 40 weeks in 2013 and 2014. Sellers in 2016 published another book, it's called Price Paid, The Fight for First Nations Survival. It's a book about life under the Indian Act. Now I want to tell you a little bit about how They Called Me Number One presents itself. It's composed of a foreword, first of all, by Chief Bill Wilson, who is Sellers' partner, a preface by Sellers, acknowledgments, 14 chapters, then an afterword by Wendy Whitwire, and then notes by Sellers. The state-sponsored horrors of the residential schools are clearly documented in this book, and the painful narration of abuse and suffering is aptly introduced in Chief Wilson's foreword by his comparison of residential schools to the Holocaust, as he describes the horrific violations of humanity at the school as Canada's Brown Holocaust, a cesspool of mental, physical, and sexual abuse. Sellers equates the mission school, which was run by the Oblates of Mary Immaculate, a French order of the Roman Catholic Church, with a prison, testifying to the rampant neglect, ridicule, shaming, frequent corporeal punishment, and sexual abuse that the Aboriginal children endured. The youngsters were emotionally and physically scarred and starved, given no affection, and fed rotten, inedible food. Forbidden to speak their native languages, they were forced to speak English and memorize the incomprehensible Latin responses to Catholic Mass. This is quote number 10. We practiced it until we got it right, with the proper pronunciation of the Latin words and when to say them, but the meaning was not translated into English for us. We were, as usual, just little robots programmed to do everything on cue. Robbed of their Aboriginal identities, of their families, whom they saw 2 weeks at Christmas and 2 weeks and 2 months in the summer, robbed of their self-confidence, creativity, and health, these children were also forced to work at the school, cleaning the yard, washing the floors, polishing the dishes and silver used by the priests and nuns, and setting the priests and nuns' tables without the benefit of a morsel of the appetizing food that was served to their keepers. Runaways were usually caught by the RCMP and returned to the school, of course, or returned by the children's parents, and they were then severely punished. Health and dental care at the school was non-existent. All in all, as Sellers puts it, referring to the mission school, it was a breeding ground for dysfunction, and most of the pupils suffered serious, lifelong after effects of the trauma they endured there. Now, in contrast to Kim Tree's Rue, where the flowers of rhetoric bloom in profusion, Sellers' narrative is more of a factual documentary testimony, but it is infused with a highly personal tone. As Wendy Wickwire states in her afterword, Sellers recounts her story with grace and composure, and it is certainly not devoid of specific discursive strategies that are crucial to the narration of her traumatic sojourn at St. Joseph's. I would briefly like to look at some of these ascetic strategies, including the title, the use of binary oppositions and quotations, the highlighting of specific words by putting them in quotation marks, and perhaps unexpectedly, in such a tale, humor. The first part of the book's title, They Called Me Number One, is rich with signification on a number of levels. It provides a compelling example of the Althusserian notion of interpolation of the subject, whereby, as Judith Butler states, the subordination of the subject takes place through language as the effect of the authoritative voice that hails the individual. Noting this founding subordination in the process of assujettissement, subjection, Butler contends that the model of power in Althusser's account attributes performative power to the authoritative voice, the voice of sanction. In Seller's case, this hailing and subjection of the subject are literally inscribed in the title, They Called Me Number One. The subject is called and put in the object position. And there's also the attribution of a number to her as a substitute for her proper name. This is quotation 11. As Sellers explains, we were given a number that would become our identity for the years at school. I became number one on the girls' side. Although other kids continued to call me by my name, Bev Sellers ceased to exist for the nuns and priests. Instead, they would say, number one, come here. Thankfully, our numbers were not tattooed on our skin, which takes us back to the beginning of the book where we have the chief's comparison of these experiences to a brown Holocaust. Sellers is thus subject to a type of identity theft, reduced in the eyes of the school authorities to a mere number which erases her proper name. Later, just prior to her confirmation, she's forced to choose a different proper name to have an official Catholic name. I had to pick the name of a saint for my confirmation name, she says. I picked the name Yvonne because that was the name of my sister Dolly's best friend. Once again, the subject's term of self-reference is imposed upon her by the Catholic Church, signifying her subjection to its authority and power, her belonging to it as one of its possessions. The official Catholic name also conveys the imposition of a foreign culture and religion upon the young girl. The title also sets up a particular construction which we find echoed through the entire text. They called me sets up an antagonistic opposition between them and me, prefiguring the opposition between the Aboriginals versus whites, us versus them, which plays an integral role in highlighting white prejudice and racism in Sellers' memoir. The difference in attitude towards the land mentioned early on in the text is but one example of this white versus indigenous opposition. As Sellers observes, before the arrival of the colonizers, indigenous people could freely harvest all of the resources from their land that they required for their survival. But this changed greatly with the arrival of the people she calls the newcomers. Quote 12, there was a clash of cultures with the arrival of the newcomers. It boiled down to the difference between attitudes towards the land. The Aboriginal attitude was that the land supplied you with everything you needed to survive, and you could access it anywhere in your territory. With the newcomers came the notion of conquering the land and private property. Fences appeared where we had always gone freely before. So here the opposition between white people and indigenous people is marked literally and figuratively by the fence dividing line, restricting movement between spaces and designating people as belonging to one or the other group. This division of people is also evident in apartheid-like creation of certain spaces for Aboriginals, such as the Squaw Dance Hall for Aboriginals at the Williams Lake Stampede. Indigenous people were not welcome at the White Dance Hall in that town. And once Sellers and the other Aboriginal children were finally allowed to leave the residential school, live at home, and attend the local mixed Williams Lake Junior Secondary School, They were not allowed to ride on the same bus as the white children. Instead, they were forced to travel on an old, decrepit, constantly backfiring vehicle known as the Indian bus. In addition, Sellers describes the negative attitude of non-Aboriginals towards certain vagrant indigenous men who lived on the street in Williams Lake, many of whom were former students of the residential school, where they were forever damaged and rendered dysfunctional. This is quote 13. Many times I have watched non-Aboriginal people walk by these street people with a look of disdain, dislike, and sometimes even a look bordering on hatred. They simply have no idea of what Aboriginal people have experienced. What do non-Aboriginal people know of this discrimination we have been put through for their benefit? What do they know of the feelings we have for them but do not show? Here, the us versus them opposition is strikingly clear. But as Derrida has taught us in De la Grammaturgie and elsewhere, if one term in a binary opposition is usually valorized over the other in a relation of hierarchy, the supposedly subordinate term is absolutely necessary for the valorized term to enjoy this hegemony. So I would contend here that Sellers' insistence on this indigenous versus non-indigenous opposition serves not to entrench any notion of white superiority, but to critique it, to undermine it, underscoring white ignorance and prejudice, resulting in a revalorization, implicitly, of Aboriginal peoples and their culture. Now there's another binary opposition that runs throughout the text that's worth mentioning. It's that that's created between the nightmarish existence at the school and the joy and happiness experienced during the time when the students were temporarily permitted to return home for the 2-week Christmas break and the 2-month summer break. The opposition between the dysphoria of the school and the euphoria of home is not unlike that in Kim Twee's text, as I've shown, where the horrors of the boat voyage and the refugee camp are contrasted with the joy of the newfound home in Quebec. Whereas the residential school was a very unhappy place of confinement and suffering, the indigenous home is described as a safe, happy haven of freedom. A lexical field of positivity is constructed by the use of terms such as relaxed atmosphere, toasty warm house, being secure, and even the food, delicious dessert, they were allowed sweets, and above all, the repetition of the word free in the following passage, it's quote 14. We were free, free to live life without constantly worrying about being punished, free to roam the countryside without worrying about staying in boundaries, free to talk to our brothers, sisters, parents, cousins, uncles, aunts, grandparents, and anyone we damn well felt like, free to relish the freedom of security that having our family around us brings. So the different types of freedom here, which form part of an enumeration in this passage, freedom from unwarranted punishment, freedom of movement, freedom of speech, freedom of security, in addition to the very positive description of the home environment, deftly underscores the negative, dysphoric aspects of the life at the residential school. Now another strategy she uses, she may not be big on metaphor, but she is very good at using quotation. Be it self-quotation, repeating her own past utterances, or the citation of the words of others. And these quotations have the effect of further emphasizing the inferior status accorded to Aboriginal people. As Antoine Compagnon has shown in his brilliant study of quotation, this iterative strategy creates a semantic constellation composed of repetition, memory, and imitation. In quoting another's utterance, the speaker takes possession of this discourse, making it her own, while simultaneously evoking the original context and speaker. In Sellers' memoir, most quoted remarks take the form of insults directed at Aboriginal people. Such is the case of the following instance of self-quotation. It's quote 15. We had a saying at the mission, if we did anything stupid, we excused ourselves with the line, oh well, I'm just an Indian. Mum remembers being called dirty Indian, stupid, and other derogatory names by the authorities at the mission. We got the same message. Although Sellers is quoting herself and her schoolmates, this is already, in fact, a quotation, for the children are reiterating insults that they have previously received and internalized.
making these words part of their own identity and self-definition. But the repetition here, I would maintain, is not simply to form part of the diegesis, to provide readers with more realistic details of the rancid and racist environment at the school, in repeating those directed at her mother. Sellers is pointing an accusatory finger at the original anonymous speakers, and thus she makes a pointed criticism of the racism and stereotypes expressed in this discourse. This iterative strategy recalls Judith Butler's much quoted definition of agency as a variation on a repetition in Gender Trouble, in addition to her work on hate speech in Excitable Speech, where insults are repeated in a new context of contestation and resistance. We find yet another example of injurious quotation in Sellers' account of her stay in hospital after a botched suicide attempt. In fact, the beginning of the book consists of, the preface is really the recounting of her attempted suicide at the age of 17. And then after that, it goes into the past and continues chronologically. In the hospital, her white nurse was unpleasant and completely devoid of empathy and kindness. Quote 16, "She made my short stay miserable. You people," I remember her angrily saying, "instead of having compassion, which is what I needed then, the white nurse made me feel like I was so stupid I couldn't even kill myself properly." Maybe that was what she was pissed off about, that I had not been successful. What is that saying I've heard a number of times? The only good Indian is a dead Indian. So in this passage, quotation is once again mobilized to emphasize and criticize the pejorative view that non-Indigenous people have of Indigenous people, and their success in inculcating these baseless stereotypes into the Aboriginal psyche. The utterance, "you people," devoid of any adjective or specific qualification, succeeds in putting all of the Aboriginals into one homogeneous, negatively coded group. Thus we hail the subjection and subjugation by the white nurse. Sellers' feelings of inferiority, shame, and stupidity are heightened. But once again, quoting these unfounded insults allows Sellers to exercise her agency, repeating the injurious discourse in the new and critical context of her memoir. Another related technique to this one is the use of certain words that are placed in quotation marks, not only to give them extra emphasis, but additional signification, most often the opposite of their original meaning. Sellers uses this strategy when recounting the routine that was followed when students would arrive at the school. First off, their belongings, all their personal belongings and clothing, were confiscated and stored in the attic, and they were given clothing from the mission. The girls' hair was then cut, and they were "deloused," in quotation marks, with the pesticide DDT, a cruel and painful procedure involving that famous noxious substance that was banned in Canada in the early 70s. Sellers puts the word "deloused" in quotation marks to criticize this unnecessary procedure, especially given that she always arrived at the mission free of head lice, but returned home for the holidays with her head full of them. If there were no head lice present, she points out, there was obviously no actual delousing going on, just pointless torture. Another instance of the quotation marks device occurs in Sellers' descriptions of her bouts with a health problem that the school nurse, but she wasn't really a nurse, it was a nun whom they called the nurse. It was very doubtful as to whether she had any kind of medical training. Anyway, this nurse would refer to this health problem as, in quotation marks, "yellow jaundice." This is quote 17. "Quite often during my time at the mission, I suffered from what the nurse said was yellow jaundice. I was sent to bed and would vomit until it seemed my guts were going to come out." Years later, when Sellers' young grandson contracted food poisoning from preparing raw chicken and not washing his hands afterwards, he was vomiting, and Sellers recognized the yellow jaundice smell of the vomit that both she and her grandmother had suffered from on a regular basis at the school. So it was not jaundice, it was food poisoning. The use of quotation marks gives the expression "yellow jaundice" the status of a euphemism used in place of the real name of the affliction, food poisoning. It also enables Sellers to indirectly voice her criticism of the poor quality rotting food that the students were forced to consume. Sometimes it was actually rotting, so they would try and throw it out without being noticed because they would be punished if they were seen throwing away food. Sometimes students were caught doing this and they were forced to take their garbage and eat the garbage. Not unlike Kim to be, Bev Sellers also incorporates humor into her text, which not only injects a somewhat lighter note into this very dark, tragic tale of trauma, but also a form of critique. In her portrait of one particularly mean and sadistic teacher at the school, Miss Bouchamet, Sellers emphasizes the latter's propensity for beating children with yardsticks. Noting the frequency of these harsh beatings, the narrator states, quote 18, "The school must have had a special budget for the yardsticks she broke on kids. Patience was definitely not one of her virtues." The latter sentence is actually the transformation of a cliché, patience is a virtue, into an understatement that connotes the teacher's short fuse and subsequent cruel behavior. Here, discursive repetition with variation affords Sellers the opportunity of criticizing the heartless behavior of the teacher with a note of humor, which nevertheless does not attenuate the severity of her critique. Elsewhere in the text, one very portly nun, who obviously had an overweight problem, is constantly telling the students that gluttony is a sin, at which they just laugh at her. Another humorous moment occurs when the narrator recounts the annual Christmas concert at the school, to which the Aboriginal children's parents were never invited. The children all had various parts to play and were given lines to recite that imitated biblical discourse. Sellers describes her own experience as follows. This is quote 19. "I was ridiculed the year I had to say, 'Go ye that way,' while gesturing with my arm in a certain direction. I was a shepherd and I had to direct the wise men toward the baby Jesus. Doreen and Christine teased me for months after Christmas. I don't know if it was the way I said it or just that it sounded funny." Now, that the words "go ye that way" would emanate from the mouth of a young child is already a bit incongruous, to say the least. But here, given the imposition of the Catholic religion on Aboriginal children, it borders on the ridiculous or the absurd. While we can certainly read the narration of this incident as a criticism of the school's indoctrination of its young charges, it is also important to note that humor functioned as a survival strategy for these abused children. As Sellers remarks when remembering some of the pranks that she and her young colleagues got away with and some of the things they didn't get away with, "I guess the sense of humor that Native people have is just another way of survival for us." Now, I've got some concluding thoughts. I'm near the end. So, as I hope to have shown, Kim Twee and Bev Sellers use a number of very different textual strategies to recount their respective traumatic experiences, to give voice to that which poses a challenge to representation. In Twee's case, the use of fragments and poetic figurative language enables her to narrate her ordeal as a refugee, but also her joy at finding a new welcome home in Quebec. Using rhetorical figures such as metaphor, comparison, personification, and a series of analeptic and proleptic narrative maneuvers, as well as a certain dose of humor, she provides a moving account of her experience as a boat person forced into exile. In contrast, Bev Sellers opts for a decidedly more colloquial register of discourse, a more chronological linear narrative, and a more realistic direct style to share with her readers the atrocities that she and many other Aboriginal children suffered at the residential schools. Her less figurative style than Twee does not, however, prevent her from mobilizing a number of discursive strategies. Binary oppositions, quotations, terms and expressions placed in quotation marks and at times humor, which prove apt and effective in communicating the highly abject life of the children at the schools and the lasting effect of the painful years of subjection on the rest of their lives. Both of these texts perform an educational didactic function in that readers learn in detail about these traumatic experiences of which they might know very little. This particular function of the trauma narrative is overtly emphasized in Sellers' memoir in at least two specific instances. In her preface, quoting Charlie Gilbert from the Williams Lake Band, she says, "People have to know and believe what happened to us. That's what hurts, when people don't believe what happened." And in her acknowledgments, when thanking family members for having read earlier drafts of her memoir, Sellers states, "As emotional as it was for some, they all encouraged me to make these stories public so that they might help others." While the referent of the term others is not specified, I would suggest that it could refer not only to the Aboriginal survivors of these schools, but also to non-Aboriginals whose understanding of these atrocities would be heightened or helped by the publication of this memoir. As I stated earlier, Fellman and Laub contend that the narration of trauma requires the empathetic reception of the reader or listener, who becomes what Derrida calls the witness of the witness. But what then, having read these texts, what then is the ethical role of the witness's witness beyond receptive listening? Is there further ethical action possible for the readers of such texts? Who can speak for whom or of whom? Sellers categorically claims, for example, that non-Aboriginal people can never become experts on Aboriginal people and their culture. And this is quotation 20. "I get really angry when non-Aboriginal people become experts on Aboriginal people. They come into territories and gather information for 4 or 5 years and become experts on, and our elders like Graham," it's her grandmother, "who have lived the life of a First Nations woman, become mere footnotes. Aboriginal people are the only experts on Aboriginal people. I don't care how many years people go to school to learn about us. Unless they have lived our lives, they are not the experts." I'm going to leave this thorny question open for discussion after my talk, and we'll conclude with one final thought. I would contend that both of these texts display a performative dimension. As Susan Bryson claims, saying something about traumatic memory does something to it. Diffuses it, renders it less intrusive, less disruptive, and transforms it into narrative memory that can be integrated into a self in the process of being rebuilt. And Sellers avows in her preface that writing this book has allowed her to grow. To make these grievous traumas public is to pass from the private sphere to the collective domain of the reader. It is simultaneously an ethical and aesthetic gesture that itself testifies to the imperative to remember and the refusal to surrender to the so-called unsayable. If trauma is described by theoreticians as an enigmatic aporia, as a knot of paradoxes, as a challenge to narration, it also encourages and in some cases demands its own representation, engendering narratives which allow for its resignification. Thanks very much for listening.